हेलो माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू आवर यूट्यूब चैनल आरएमके रेजोल्यूशंस। नाउ टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक ऑन द अबाउट द प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन, सम ब्रीफ अबाउट द प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन। रिमेंबर दिस वीडियो इज फॉर द ग्रेजुएट स्टूडेंट्स बिकॉज दिस इज वेरी सिंप्लीफाइड मैटर वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस। सो ऑल ऑफ वी नो दैट प्लाज्मा मेम्ब्रेन it is the thin and flexible which is surrounding the cell, surrounding the bacterial cell. It also surrounds the plant as well as the animal cell. So plasma membrane, it is the flexible in nature and that act as a barrier. So on the screen you can see there is fluid mosaic model. In early days many scientists try to understand the nature of the plasma membrane and they also try to understand which kind of biomolecules are present in the membrane. Later on it is concluded that plasma membrane having a three biomolecules, that is proteins, lipids and carbohydrate, but most of them are unaware what is the arrangement of that molecule. But in 1972, there is two scientists, Singer and Nicholson. They propose a model of plasma membrane and that membrane model is universally accepted, which is called as the fluid mosaic model. Now we try to understand the meaning of that fluid mosaic model, why that model is called as a fluid mosaic model. So as I said, plasma membrane is flexible in nature, so that flexibility is because of the lipid present in the membrane. So on your screen you can see that there is a large iceberg which is floating on the seawater. So proteins are embedded in the lipid bilayer in this fashion, like a iceberg which is floating on the sea water. Now you can see the structure of the fluid mosaic model clearly. See, this is the cholesterol present in the plasma membrane. So before cholesterol you can see this is the lipid bilayer, which is the most important component of the plasma membrane, and there are two leaflets. This is the outer leaflets and this is the inner leaflet of the membrane. Now you can see this is the extracellular fluid, means outside the cell, and this is the integral portion. This one is the integral portion of the cell. So this lipid bilayer is which is very important. Then we can see here there are some proteins which are embedded into the membrane. So this protein act as a channel for the transport purposes. Now here there is some another integral proteins which are completely buried in the lipid bilayer. This is the cytoplasm, and here there are some carbohydrates which is attached to the lipid as well as to the protein. So in the diagram you can see three biomolecules, and these three biomolecules, how these biomolecules are arranged in the plasma membrane. So this is the plasma membrane fluid mosaic model. Later on we are going to discuss the function of plasma membrane and functions of each protein as well as lipid and carbohydrate. So first try to understand the chemical composition of the plasma membrane. As I told you, plasma membrane, it is having a three macromolecule, or we can say biomolecule, that is lipid, protein and carbohydrate. So first we will try to understand the membrane lipids. So membrane lipids, there are different types of lipids are found in the plasma membrane. Out of that, 75% is the phospholipid. Then 20% or 20 to 30%, that number is vary from membrane to membrane. So 20 to 30% there is a cholesterol, and 5% there is a glycolipid, means when carbohydrates is attached to the lipid, then it is called as the glycolipid. So another point which is very important here, the lipids which are present in the membrane, they are amphipathic in nature. Amphipathic means they having both polar as well as the non-polar part. One lipid having polar as well as the non-polar part. So this particular plasma membrane, they act as a permeability barrier. Plasma membrane, it is called as the selectively permeable in nature. So plasma membrane, first of all, it is essential for the maintenance of the fluidity. This particular lipid, it is important to maintain the fluidity. That's why it is called as the fluid mosaic model. Fluid, because of the that fluid word is because of the lipid. Mosaic means proteins are randomly arranged in the plasma membrane. So that's why it is called as the fluid mosaic model of the plasma membrane. So as I said, this particular lipid, which are amphipathic in nature. So why it is amphipathic, this phospholipid? Because see here in the diagram, you can see this is the lipid present in the membrane, and this particular lipid, it having a two parts. This part which we called as a head, and this head, it is hydrophilic in nature, that is, it is water soluble in nature, and this tail, it is called as the hydrophobic, means it is water heating or water insoluble in nature. Now see this particular head why it is called as hydrophilic, because it having a phosphate groups. So not only phosphate groups, but different kinds of charge or polar molecule is attached over there. Sometimes sphingolipid, so sphingosine is going to attach over there. So that's why it is polar head, and this one is the non-polar tail. Non-polar means hydrophobic, means this is the water insoluble in nature, and that's why membrane lipid is called as the amphipathic lipid. Amphipathic means they having a both hydrophilic as well as the hydrophobic ends. Now you can see there are different kinds of lipids are present. Phosphatidyl choline is there. When choline group is attached, then it is called as a phosphatidyl choline. Then phosphatidyl ethanomine, phosphatidyl serine, phosphatidyl inositol, these are the lipids which are present in the membrane. So as I told earlier, cholesterol is also present in the membrane. So cholesterol, which is the very important component of the plasma membrane, cholesterol, which is the organic molecule, the nature is the sterol, and cholesterol, it is also the precursor for the different steroid hormone. It is also the precursor for the vitamin D and bile acid. And remember, my dear friends, cholesterol is absent in the prokaryotic cell. So try to understand what is the function of this cholesterol. Cholesterol helps to maintain the fluidity of the plasma membrane. The hydroxyl group of the cholesterol, it is going to interact with the water molecule. So cholesterol molecule, they are weakly amphipathic in nature, and they interspread within a membrane. There is no such fixed pattern, and they also interact with the lipids in the membrane. Then glycolipids, they are also present in the membrane, and remember, glycolipids, they are attached, or we can say, you can see in the picture, this is the outside portion of the cell and this is the inside portion of the cell. So carbohydrates which is attached over here, so carbohydrates which is attached only to the outer leaflets of the membrane. Carbohydrates are not attached to the inner leaflets. As I said, this is the outer leaflet of the membrane and this one is the inner leaflet. So carbohydrates, they are attached only to the outer leaflet of the plasma membrane. This is a very important point. Carbohydrates are not present in the inner leaflets. So that's why glycolipids, they are present only to the outer face of the membrane because they have a specific function. We will discuss later on the function of the glycolipid. So we discuss about the lipid. Now we are going to discuss about the proteins which are present in the membrane. So there are two types of proteins which are present in the membrane. One is the integral protein and second one is the peripheral protein. Now integral protein means what? Those proteins which are completely buried or completely embedded in the membrane or lipid bilayer, that is called as the integral protein. It is also called as the intrinsic protein. And another type, extrinsic protein or peripheral protein, which are partially buried in the membrane, which is called as the peripheral or extrinsic protein. So peripheral protein, it is not embedded completely in the membrane. So peripheral proteins, they are loosely attached to the polar head groups of the plasma membrane. So many membrane proteins are the glycoproteins. Most of the proteins, they are the glycoproteins, because when carbohydrates is attached to the protein, then it is called as a glycoprotein. And when carbohydrate moieties are attached to the lipid, then it is called as the glycolipids. So you can see here, these are the on your screen, there are membrane proteins shown. This is the integral protein which is completely buried in the membrane, and here you can see these are the peripheral proteins which are not completely buried. So we can isolate this peripheral protein by some detergent treatment. And you can see here, this is the carbohydrate moiety which is attached to the lipid, and here this carbohydrate which is attached to the protein. So this protein is the glycoprotein. So protein which is present in the membrane, they having a different functions. So now first is the ion channel. This protein, they act as a ion channel for the transport of ions, with the different ions which is required for the growth of the cell or for the different biochemical reactions. So these ions are transported through the proteins. Then proteins are also act as a carrier for the transport purposes. Then most of the protein, they act as a receptor for the intracellular signaling. Okay, so they act as a receptor. Then some enzyme, some proteins, they act as an enzyme. We can take an example of the mitochondrial membrane, inner membrane. So there are different kinds of enzymes are present. So plasma membrane, they provide a platform for the different biochemical reaction. Most of the many proteins, they act as an enzyme, that is, they increase the rate of reactions. As I told you, that inner mitochondrial membrane, there are different enzymes are there which helps to produce the ATP. Okay, so they also act as an enzyme. And proteins, they also plays an important role for the maintaining the identity of the particular cell. That is, the glycoprotein and glycolipids, they maintain the identity. For example, if you take the example of RBC, there are different blood groups. We know that AB and O. So why the different blood groups? Because of the lipids. Because of this particular proteins and lipids. Now membrane carbohydrates, they are covalently bound to the lipid. They are going to form a glycolipids. Covalently bound to the protein, then they are going to form a glycoprotein. So glucose is there, galactose, mannose, N-acetyl glucosamine and N-acetyl galactosamine. These are the major sugars or carbohydrates, we can say, which is going to attach to the membrane. Now, the transport across the membrane, cell membrane. Cell membrane plays a very important role, that is the transport. Transport of the material across the plasma membrane, and the transport is essential for the cell's survival. And that transport is also important to maintain the equilibrium of the cell. So most of the substances, they are moving inside in from outside to inside or from inside to outside the cell. So you'll see there are two type of transport. Actually, there are three types. Number one is the passive transport. Number two is the active transport. And number three is the bulk transport. That is, transport takes place in a bulk. Now, this particular passive transport, it having a two types. Simple diffusion and facilitated diffusion. There is another type which is called as the osmosis. This is also the type of the passive transport. And active transport, again it having a two types, primary active transport and secondary active transport. So first try to understand the difference between passive transport and active transport. In case of the passive transport, there is no need of the metabolic energy, and in case of the active transport, there is need a metabolic energy in the form of ATP. So first we'll focus on the passive transport. Now passive transport, as I told you, there are three types. Osmosis we'll see later on. So first is the simple diffusion. So here the movement of particles from the area of higher concentration to the area of lower concentration, that is down to the concentration gradient across the membrane. So that kind of transport is called as the simple diffusion. So here there is no need of any carrier, and this particular simple diffusion, they does not require the energy. This is also the very important point. So we can see the examples. There is a transport of different gases from outside to inside or from inside to outside, then transport of different ions, then transport of lipid soluble substances which are directly cross to the membrane, because we know that the membrane, they are made up of the bilayer. Membrane, it is made up of the bilayer. So lipid soluble molecule, they directly cross to the membrane. So that's why lipid soluble molecule, they directly cross the membrane by the simple diffusion. Then facilitated diffusion, this is the second type of the passive transport. So here it require some carrier. See here, carrier is required for the transport purposes, but in this transport also, transport takes place from higher concentration to the lower concentration, that is down to the concentration gradient, or we can say towards the concentration gradient. But only difference is that here it require a carrier. But in this transport also, there is no requirement of the energy. So example, there are absorption of the fructose, then glucose transport across the plasma membrane takes place by the facilitated diffusion. So here it is important to know about the uniport and antiport. So this particular transport based on the direction of movement of molecule, which what is the direction? So suppose we can say uniport, that is a transport of single type of molecule in one direction. Example, absorption of the fructose. So you can see in the diagram, there is only single molecule and they are transported through carrier in a single direction. So that is called as the uniport. And antiport, transport of molecule in a opposite direction. Example, chloride bicarbonate exchange in the RBC. This is a very important process for the maintaining the pH of the blood plasma. So this particular antiport, which is the example of the passive transport, and this transport is the one molecule transported in this direction and another molecule is transported in a opposite direction. So this kind of transport is called as the antiport. Osmosis, one of the most important, and this is very important because many students, they get confused about the osmosis. Though it looks a simple, but actually osmosis, it is very important to understand. So osmosis, this is the type of the passive transport, and here in case of the osmosis, the diffusion of water molecule through the semi-permeable membrane, water molecule, or we can say the solvent. So see the proper definition of the osmosis: movement of water molecule or movement of the solvent from area of low solute concentration to an area of high solute concentration is called as the osmosis. Transport of solvent, we can say water or solvent, from low solute concentration to high solute concentration is known as the osmosis. Again, here there is no need of the energy. So there are different clinical significance of the osmosis. So they decrease the formation of urine, hypovolemic conditions, and different kinds of clinical significance of osmosis there. I'll make a detailed video on the osmosis later on. Okay, now let's see about the active transport. So we have seen the passive transport. Now active transport, there are two types: primary active transport and secondary active transport. So in case of the active transport, transport takes place against the concentration gradient, that is from low solute concentration to high solute concentration, and for such kind of transport some energy is needed, so ATP is required for this transport. So active transport, there are two types: primary active transport and secondary active transport. So first we'll focus on the primary active transport. So transport, as I told you, transport against the concentration gradient. And obviously, when transport is against, that is from low solute concentration to high solute concentration, then obviously there is a need of the energy. So directly energy is utilized in the form of ATP. And again, carrier, obviously carrier is necessary for such kind of transport. It requires energy in the form of ATP. So we can take many examples, that is the sodium potassium pumps which are present on the membrane, then calcium pumps which are present on the endoplasmic reticulum membrane, then there are H plus ATPase which are present on the lysosomal membrane. So these are the examples of the primary active transport. So first we'll see the sodium potassium pumps. It is also called as the Na plus K plus ATPase. See, this is the antiport here, means that ATPase is here, that protein, it having enzymatic activities. They break down the ATP, they having that kind of activity. So in case of the Na plus K plus ATPase, which are present on the most of the membrane, and here the transport of three sodium ion, they are moving outside the cell, and simultaneously two potassium ions, they are moving inside the cell. So cell maintain such kind of situation. Cell try to maintain the low concentration of sodium inside the cytoplasm, and cell try to maintain the high concentration of K plus inside the cell. That's why 3 Na plus, it is transported outside, and 2K plus it is taking inside. And for this transport, now this transport is against the concentration gradient. So for this transport, one ATP molecule is needed. So the last point clearly indicate that this particular Na plus K plus ATPs, they are maintaining the low intracellular Na plus and high intracellular K plus. So in the diagram you can see clearly, this is the Na plus K plus ATPs. It is made up of the two alpha subunits and two beta subunits. So these two alpha subunits, they are the larger subunits, and beta subunit, it is the smaller subunit. Remember that alpha subunit, they having a ATPase activity, so they are going to break the ATP. So when ATP is broken down, then some sort of energy is released, and that energy is utilized for the transport of 3 Na plus outside the cell and 2K plus inside the cell. So 3 Na plus, it is moving outside, and 2K plus it is taking inside. 3 Na plus. So remember, cell try to maintain such kind of situation. Cell try to maintain the equilibrium. That's why earlier I said that proteins, they plays an important role in the maintaining the equilibrium of the cell. Now there are many examples are there. Many examples of the primary active transport, we have seen only one. There is another Ca2 plus ATPs, then H plus ATPs, which are present on the lysosomal membrane. So this particular all these primary active transport, we'll see. I'll make another video, detailed video on the primary active transport. I will move towards the secondary active transport. So in case of the secondary active transport, again this is the transport against the concentration gradient, but they don't utilize the energy directly, they utilize the energy indirectly, and the transport of two or three molecules are coupled here. We have seen earlier the antiport. So such kind of transport takes place here in the secondary transport. We can say, see here, Na plus K plus ATPs. So along with the Na plus K plus ATPs, that when Na plus is going outside, then simultaneously glucose is also going outside. So this is symport. Transport simultaneously takes place in a one direction. So symport, this is also called as a co-transport. Molecule is moving in the same direction. Example, sodium glucose symport is there, then sodium amino acid symport is also there. And antiport, it is also called as a counter transport. So here molecule is moving in a opposite direction. We can see the example, sodium hydrogen exchangers and calcium hydrogen exchanger. So we have seen the two types, primary passive transport and active transport. Now third transport is the bulk transport. So bulk transport, here the large amount of molecule, it is transported from outside to inside or from inside to outside. So we know that inside the cell there is a different metabolism is going on. So during the metabolism, some kind of waste molecule is secreted inside the cell. So that particular waste molecule, it is thrown outside the cell with the help of exocytosis. So when transport takes place from inside to outside, then it is called as the exocytosis. And when transport takes place from outside to inside, then it is called as the endocytosis. So different kinds of bacteria, viruses, they are taken inside by the endocytosis process. So in case of the bulk transport, there is no carrier involved, but plasma membrane involved here. So plasma membrane plays an important role in the bulk transport. So in this video we'll see in a very brief about the bulk transport. I'll make another video on the bulk transport in detail. So we'll see in brief exocytosis, that is transport of molecule from inside to outside, and endocytosis, that is the engulfing. And endocytosis, or there is some another word, phagocytosis, it is called as a cell eating, that is engulfing of the large molecule by the cell. So there are many types of the endocytosis. Here there is mentioned phagocytosis, that is the large substances such as the bacteria, viruses, they are taking inside by the macrophages. This is the one very important cell, immune system, and they actively participate in a phagocytosis process. As I told you, there is a different video on the phagocytosis. And pinocytosis, it is called as the cell drinking. So fluid molecule is just taking inside the cell. You can see here, this is the endocytosis process. As I told you, plasma is involved in this particular transport. So these outer molecule, they are taking inside. So plasma membrane is invaginating, and they are going to form a vesicle. So this is the vesicle form with the help of the plasma membrane. And then this is the lysosome, which is derived from the Golgi complex. So this lysosome, they have a different lytic enzymes present inside. So this particular we can say this is the phagosome and lysosome, they are going to fuse together. So fluid molecules in the lysosome, they are going to digest, means all that material which is taking inside, it is digested with the help of the lysosomal enzyme, and then this digested material, it is thrown out of the cell. Okay, so this is the phagocytosis in very short. I'll make another video in detail on the phagocytosis. So this is the type of the endocytosis, or we can say the bulk transport. So thank you very much. Please like the video, subscribe my channel RMK Resolutions, and hit the bell icon for the more updates. Thank you. Bye.